We know the saying, strike while the iron is hot. That means when our expectations are aligned in a certain direction, that is when something needs to happen. Because if our expectations are aligned in a different direction, different way, it's not going to really feel right and not be able to go along with it. So strike while the iron is hot. This is something that is so important. And I you know, we'll see how it goes. I just feel that more can be done. More can be done. The dream I had 2 nights ago is something that I'm continuing to consider, because it was quite an extraordinary dream. And I took it to mean maybe to stay away from graphics, but maybe it wasn't that, you know. Maybe it was a much more positive, something much more positive. Certainly I met some resistance in this dream. I met some resistance. And so we want to have our expectations aligned, and then we want something to happen to meet those expectations and to help carry us further. And this dream had to do with the old saying, pull out all the stops. Pull out all the stops. That comes from organ music. Organs that have these stops you pull. And the dream involved a Hammond B3 organ that somehow had just been, I somehow ordered it, and it somehow appeared on my driveway in the morning. I got up in the morning, and there was this package, a beautiful, refurbished Hammond B3 electric organ. And I started to set it, you know, get it, plug it in, get it ready, and started to, you know, play and get some tones, and it was really an extraordinary situation. And of course, the Hammond B3 organ has these stops that you pull out, like 9 different stops, and you could slide them in and out, and you get different tones out of it. It was very popular in the 60s. I think, like, you know, a lot of groups use those, like the Rascals, Young Rascals, certainly. Felix Gagliardi played a Hammond B3. Moody Blues, I think that the Emerson, Lake and Palmer, of course, had a Hammond B3, but a lot of groups. It was on so many different songs in the 60s, the Hammond B3 and the 70s. So here I get a Hammond B3 delivered to my in my driveway, sitting in my driveway. I mean, what am I supposed to say to that? I don't know. I don't know. You have a dream like that. What can you say? I believe it might have to do with pulling out all the stops. Some sort of when you pull out all the stops on the Hammond B3, this you get the full blast, full volume going through Leslie's speaker cabinet, and. So maybe it means it's time to pull out all the stops. And it said on it, a little emblem there said collegiate, which collegiality means working together with mutual respect and regard and responsibility towards an objective. It's an attitude, a collegiate, it's like colleagues, these are my colleagues. So apparently I was sort of, I guess you say I was accepted as a colleague. Which is quite amazing. Some sort of collegiality was indicating that I'm a colleague of what? I don't know exactly. But maybe it's time for some beautiful music in a spiritual sense, some beauty, spiritual beauty. The Hammond B3 was a beautiful, beautiful musical instrument that gave these very celestial, beautiful tones. Maybe it's time for us to pull out all the stops, meaning go all in. Everything now is on the line. Let's pull out all the stops, and let's do everything we can, or rather experience everything we can. Not so much do, but experience. And experience what? Experiencing no outcomes, no valuing, no concretization, peace of mind, bliss, situations that get us closer to that. We need to pull out all the stops. So, you know, why such a dream arises and dreams arise is difficult to say. But that seems to be in alignment with what we're going towards here. Which is to experience our freedom, actually. A reflection of our freedom. Now, it's very important to point out that those who are talking about abidance can't possibly be humanists. It's impossible. The humanism and its goals are completely contrary to abidance and those who talk of truth. They're not compatible in the slightest bit. So, you know, if anyone's going to speak truth in this world, they cannot be a humanist. It's impossible. Absolutely impossible. That's not to say that we're judging them. We're just saying that you can't do both. You cannot do both. If you're a humanist, you're speaking what is contrary to truth, actually. Believing in what is totally contrary to truth. And unfortunately, like the 60s, we think the 60s was really, well, it was the humanist decade, wasn't it? And it's gone on from there. You know, people just got to be free. Speaking of the young rascals, you know, everybody just got to be free. People have to be free. They have to be free to be humans, free to be, you know, to express themselves fully as humans. And you know, this is humanism. And I also say that atheists and religionists are actually two sides of the same coin. Those who speak truth are not religionists either. They're not religionists. Religionists and atheists are two sides of the same coin of distracting us away from what is really true. So you can't really be a religionist either, if you want to speak the truth. You can't be a religionist, you can't be a humanist, you can't be an atheist, you can't be... I mean, there's very little you can be except just be speak the truth. And there's so few that even understand or can relate to what you're saying. You certainly need... It's hell if you don't have the compensation of abidance here. If you don't have that, then it's absolute hell, and which I've been experiencing. Because, you know, at least if nobody can understand or listening to you or whatever, at least you have a compensation of abidance in bliss. You see, that has to be present. Otherwise, it's just a nightmare. There's just this thin layer of those in the world who can relate to this, and other than that, there's just this extreme darkness here. Extreme continuity fear that keeps the mind clouded, very clouded and dark, full of fear and illogic and etc. So we those who speak truth seem to be a very tiny fragment minority here, and There's no humanism here. You're not getting humanism here. You get humanism from virtually everyone in the world, but not here. Because humanism will never lead us to truth. It leads us away from truth. So in all these videos, I pepper it with all this clarifications and you know, insight into truth. That is, it points out that, you know, that this is very different than a humanism, extraordinarily different, and extraordinarily different from religion. Really, most religion, not all. So some high traditions of, you know, religions have are pointing to truth, but a religionist, you know, is generally no closer to the truth than an atheist, actually. Atheist says, well, God didn't create this universe, this world, human bodies, there's no God. Well, they're right about that, but they're completely wrong about what their explanation is. Well, what did create it? They say, well, nothing. It just all has come together by chance and happenstance, and this is completely wrong there. So, and the religionist says, well, God created every last thing here in humans and bodies and death and suffering and misery and the world and the universe and time, space, process. Well, it's all God's work, which is completely false. But at least they I don't know how much credit you want to give because it's not true. We did. This is a mental projection of spirit, all this. This is not God's handiwork at all. God would, to say that this is God's handiwork is so such a bizarre statement that it's, and people say, well, it's consciousness. Yeah, well, consciousness is not really our identity. Not really. It really goes hand in hand with perception. We're beyond consciousness. You know, the human consciousness movement. That was the 60s, the 70s. The human potential, human consciousness movement. No, that's not it. And even the big consciousness is not quite it really either. So we hear stuff here like, well, God is not the, you know, architect of universes or worlds, which is true. God's not the architect of worlds or universes. We are. Well, we meaning spirit. And we think, oh, this is God, so God created us to make worlds and universes. No. No, we made this as a diversion, a distraction. An extreme distraction from the truth of what we are. I mean, how can we pretend that we're not what we are unless we have extreme distraction, which is kind of, you know, clouding our awareness of what we truly are? It's very difficult for us to cloud our awareness of what we are, to cloud our knowing of what we are. So we had to work really hard at it and come up with something that can temporarily mystify us and confuse us and cloud our knowingness of what we are. You can say this is the bodies, forms, world, time, space, process, and form is what we've come up with. God doesn't have anything to do with that. God knows us exactly as we are, which is completely formless, timeless, formless spirit. Now, and there are those who say, for instance, that Jesus is going to come back and judge and condemn and annihilate and wrath. No, Jesus knows that everyone has perfect standing. All spirit has perfect standing with God because God created spirit perfect. So there's absolutely no cause for anger whatsoever. Nobody judging, deserving punishment, because all have perfect standing. So that Jesus knows this perfectly. So how could he come back with some sort of righteous anger? This would be completely contrary. This is a humanistic projection, which is why I say religionists and atheists are two sides of the one coin of humanism, actually. They really are. The coin of humanism has on one side you have the atheists, and the other side you have the religionists. That's a false coin, entirely. So humanists have projected upon, like for instance Jesus, projected upon their own continuity fear and the defenses against it, and just assuming, well, Jesus came to help me defend against continuity fear. And so this must be what it is like. And no, Jesus doesn't have any continuity fear and knows, came to encourage us to evaporate our continuity fear, not to defend against it. Now, pulling out all the stops, what does that mean? Full blast, full power, full blast. What does that mean? Well, I don't know, but I tell you what, we've been in a severe drought, spiritual drought in this world of unprecedented proportions. Intensity of the spiritual drought is just horrible. I mean, all we get is the false coin of humanism, whether it's, you know, one side is, you know, atheism and secularity, and the other side religionism and spirituality. You know, we get, that's all we're getting. We're not getting the truth. We're not, you know, it's just like very little rain. There's a few little drops. It's just, you know, where's the heavy rain here? So, what an extraordinary dream to have a Hammond B3. You wake up and walk out in your driveway, and it's sitting there in your driveway in a packet, in a crate, on a pallet. It's on a shipping pallet, you know, wrapped in bubble wrap and plastic or something, and it's just sitting there in your driveway. I said, but thing is, I know what to do with it. You see, this is the thing. It's like, so it's not a totally crazy dream. It's like I say, ah. I brought it inside of the house, you know, and, you know, say, okay, you know, let me start going to work, and let me start playing it. That's right. Make beautiful music, and you would say probably spiritually. I read something that said that if you get an organ as a present like that, it's a supremely great dream, that it's God's gift. It's a gift that God gives to those who are prepared of great blessing and grace. It's a supremely spiritual dream. In other words, now one's able to express in a beautiful way. There's an expression. There's a vibe, you know, there's a vibe. There's a spiritual spin to everything. Leslie speakers, they spun, at least the bottom and the top one. In the middle, there was a big, I don't know, 14-inch speaker that handled more of the bass tones. And they had these kind of trumpets, kind of like, trumpet-shaped horn-shaped. Two horns in each top and the bottom on an axis, they would spin around, and it gave this sort of vibrato resonance to the sound. Well, there you go, resonance. You know, this is sort of a vibrato, a vibration, a resonance, a vibration. So maybe, you know, the dream's talking about this very powerful vibration resonating with truth. And here it is, you know, just delivered to me. Of course, I ordered it. I placed my order. I said, this is what I want. And then there it was. That's pretty cool. I remember it cost like $1,000 or something. I said, was it 1,000? What does that mean? 1,000? 1,000? I don't know. Flack, and people said, you need to give it back. I said, oh wow. I said, don't worry, I'll be able to pay you back. I said, no. There was just a lot of anger towards me, and grumbling, and people saying, nah, you can't, don't do that. Well, maybe it was the warmongers, maybe it was the conflict mongers, maybe it was the ego that was so upset because the last thing they want is peace. You know, the entrenched interests, the money in this world is built on fear, which leads to greed, which leads to conflict, which leads to stress, which leads to bad health. You know, just the whole world, the economy is based on suffering, actually, if you dig into it. And so if you have something beautiful in this world that you know, they say, ah, get out of here. We don't like that. You know, this is, you know, cut into our profits. We don't want to go in that direction. I got a very strong backlash against this. I said, what's the problem? You know, just listen to the music. It'll sound great. And I'm not, again, speaking spiritually. I say it's a spiritual dream. Musicians are the last people in the world you should listen to as far as their ideologies. They're the most blinded, corrupted people in the world, because they'll make a deal with the devil to enable them to keep playing music. It severely clouds their reason, music. You know, but if whatever helps them, their music in any way, oh, that's okay, it's okay, it's music. That so music excuses everything for musicians. Everything is excused. As long as they can keep going, you know, playing with their music. They'll accept, you know, lies as true if they can keep playing their music. They'll accept any deal with the devil to keep playing their music. They'll believe in magic, you know, put their faith in magic as long as they can keep playing, you know, playing their music, because it's a stress buster for them. But in the 60s, you know, in the 70s, the musicians set the agenda, which was a humanist agenda. And people just said, it's okay because we got good music, and so what's wrong with that? You know, so it's kind of like a lure that you know, for fish, catching fish. You got the music there, and then you got the hook of the false coin of humanism, and you get hooked in by it. We want to be truly free, truly happy. We want to get what we truly deserve. You know, we deserve so much better than the belief system of humanism. This is just absolute wretchedness for what we truly are. The idea that the beliefs of humanism, that this is an absurdity. It's as if we looked at a little piece of dust and said, you know, oh, that's what I am. That's the fullness of totality of what I am. This is the greatness, little piece of dust. You know, this of course is ridiculous. So somehow I made the mistake of giving up abidance to try. I thought that maybe that would help because people weren't relating to what I was saying. So I said, well, maybe they're not relating because they if I, you know, the abidance thing, they can't relate to that. So if I give that up, then they will relate. No, they still didn't relate. And then I didn't have abidance. So it was hell. That's just, but you become so desperate in this world to help out here. And the resistance here is so extraordinary that you think, like, just, you know, what can I do? What can I do? What can I do? Can I do? Well, now I see that giving up abidance is foolish. It doesn't help out at all. It's a lose-lose situation. Everybody loses. Time to pull out all the stops. So what is God going to do? Pull out all the stops with God the Holy Spirit. I believe it would be an absolute tragedy if in hindsight we look back at this time we're in now and nothing happened, you know, spiritually. We didn't pull out all the stops. That would just be, you know, reprehensible. I don't know how we could forgive ourselves. This world is all about pulling out all the stops whenever we can. It would be a tragedy and a travesty if that didn't happen, didn't take place. Incomprehensible to me, completely incomprehensible why it would not happen. No excuse. It doesn't matter if most of the world is will reject it or pay no attention. That doesn't matter. That's not the point. The point is that we deserve it. Even if no one listened, we still deserve it. We always deserve the Holy Spirit doing everything it can on our behalf and advocating for truth. Even if we're all resistant to it, we still deserve it. This is very important. Again, even if everyone rejects it, that doesn't make God mad at all. God says you still deserve it. You're still 100% deserving. You can never get away from that. So I'll try again, and I'll try again, and I'll try again. I'll never stop trying until you're all get what you truly deserve, which is perfection. So we need a God and that keeps trying and keeps trying and doesn't stop trying. And it just seems like recently, you know, the trying, it just has not seemed to be there so strongly. I feel that now we need tremendous effort, even though we may reject it. Still, you know, in the back of our minds, we'll say, hey, God hasn't forgotten about us. Even though we're, you know, putting our head in the sand of humanism, we realize God's still knocking at our door and say, hey, you know, I haven't forgot about you. I'm still shining the truth for you, the truth of your being, and I won't stop just because you stick your head in the sand. We're worth it. We truly deserve that. We're worth that. You see, this is what's really important. We are really worth the effort. We're worth it. Of course we're worth it, because we're perfect. We're an extension of God. So God cannot just say, oh, they're so hard-headed and stubborn. I'm so upset and frustrated. I just give up. You know, that's not God, the Holy Spirit, or God, the Prime Creator, or God the Son. I think in the back of everyone's mind, we're terrified that God might give up. And so we think, well, we better try to find some alternative now, because I think God's going to eventually get tired. And no, God cannot give up. It's impossible. So there's no point in testing this theory out. It just goes nowhere. We think, oh yeah, if I accept, repent now, okay, I'm saved. But if I didn't, I wouldn't have been saved. This is not true. This is not true. We have as much time as however much time we want to take for as far as in terms of how long do we want to pretend we're not what we really are. Well, as long as we want. Doesn't change anything. But what we are is timeless, so time has no effect on what we are. God knows us as timeless, non-concretized, timeless. So pulling out all the stops here, that's what I want. Today I said, hey, we need to start having some meetings. I mean, I just reading, you know, spiritual history, the history of. Like in the 19th century, in the earlier 20th century, and so much, you know, these great teachers were meeting with millions of people and going around, and they talked about how the rich tradition of so many enlightened beings just showing up and meeting with disciples and meeting with people, and then they just go disappear into the jungle or something, or you know, go away and they show up somewhere else, and there's just this huge amount of interaction going on, and just they'd show up. You know, they're moving around, they'd show up, they're active, it seems like. And it, you know, what happened to that? You know, how could that disappear? It doesn't make any sense at all why it would disappear. So they, you know, the great teachers should just start showing up to people all over the world. This is what I believe should happen. Just start showing up. Just start meeting with people all over the world. It doesn't matter. The backstory doesn't really matter. You know, you might say they're producing the backstory, where just showing up, just appearing, this is the backstory to, in hindsight, we'll look back and say, oh yeah, okay, that was the start of something really great. It's just, you know, that was how our liberation began to, you know, get off the ground. They don't really have to give any more backstory than that. Just started showing up. You know, today, you know, I like to say today I had a talk with Jesus, for instance. Jesus actually showed up right here in the world, and we had a little talk, or rather I would say I'd probably just be silent. And I say I don't have any questions. Just sit still without any questions. Because truth is unquestionably true. And when we experience it, we know it. There aren't any questions. So we're so used to asking questions because we're trying to reach outcomes. I feel, which outcome is this a good outcome? Or how good of an outcome is this? It's never absolute. So we always say, well, how good of an outcome is this? And what are the downsides? But in truth, abiding in truth, there are no questions. So probably the best practice to do is just simply sit quietly with no questions. We could say to Jesus, I don't have any questions for you. Because what we're really saying is, we're saying the truth, I don't have any questions for truth, really. When we experience truth, then we know it's unquestionably true. And that's, you know, the end of questions. Right? So we can't question what is unquestionably true and abide with it. Because we'll say, well, I'm not getting answers to my question. There really isn't an answer except to say it's unquestionably true. It's experienced as such. So if you go one step further and then question that, then the abidance is not taking place. So when the great ones start showing up in this world, it's certainly the right time for that to happen. From the way I look at it, my gosh, why waiting would just seem to be crazy at this point. We need to start getting momentum and get our option going here off the ground. Get our option off the ground. Time to get our option off the ground. And you just say, okay, let me just sit here and, you know, and with no questions. We're so used to, like, satsang, where somebody comes up, who has a question? You have a question. Okay, come on up here. All right, what's your question? Well, you know, and then da 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 da. And then the one holding satsang, the teacher holding satsang, will say, okay, let's take a look and try to answer this question for you. What is this smell? It's a tin smell. Wow, I don't know what that is. It's a little odd. Can't quite place it, but I know I've smelled it before. you know, be better, I think, if the teacher said, okay, who is willing to have no questions at all? Suspend questions. Who's here is willing to have no questions? You are? Come on up here. Sit here. And they just sit quietly with no questions. How often do we do that, have a mind which is just free of all questions? You know, we really have to consciously use our will, don't we, for that? We're always being bombarded with questions. Speaking of that, I remember before I started playing the B3 Hammond organ that I felt all these mental currents at play, terrible, conflicting, frantic, and then somehow I slipped past those. And it was free, so there's no questing, there's no questioning, no looking for outcomes, comparing outcomes, questioning how to get better outcomes, questioning how we can make illusions real, how far along are we, where are we at with this. When you experience truth, you say, this is it, I don't have any questions. This is unquestionably true. So there's no questions. But we equate questioning with progress. Towards what? Towards outcomes. Which we think will make us happy, which won't, because outcomes really ultimately really don't exist. But we equate questioning with defending against our continuity fear. Now, people like music because it tends to mask our questioning. It's sort of like a drug. It masks. But ultimately, when the music stops and everything, and you look at your mind, it's still, you know, it's really humming with all this, it's still there. Like a way a perfume might mask how we smell. But when the perfume is not there, we still smell the same. Smell is certainly something I can't figure out exactly. See, I'm not sure where it's coming from. It's not the most pleasant smell. Oh well, just have to carry on. The experiencing itself is the answer that we've been looking for. There isn't some other answer. And we say, well, no, I want to know it's true without experiencing that it's true. Who wants to know that? What wants to know that? It's like saying, I want to know without knowing. That's continuity fear, isn't it? To say I want to know without knowing. So we need to keep evaporating that continuity fear. Because when we meet a great teacher, they know the truth. They're radiating the truth. They're dropped all pretense. And all we want to do is experience it. So their presence helps us experience it. So we don't need to be thinking of questions at all. We just need to be sitting quietly and trying not to ask questions. So we actually begin to feel the truth, and then there's no questions in the truth. Truth is unquestionably true. So to say I have no questions is to say I believe you're a true teacher. That's what it really means when you say I have no questions. And from a pragmatic continuity fear standpoint, the deal, you could say, well, I neither have questions nor do I not have questions, and let it just be this expression of negative positive expression of zero. And that would probably help out. Maharshi didn't say, people come to him and says, okay, everybody, thanks for coming, okay, now, what are your questions you want to have answered? Ask me some questions. Yeah, no, he just stayed absolutely silent, right? And people would come and they say, I don't have any questions. I just want to sit here quietly. I can feel the truth. I don't need to question the truth. When you're feeling truth, you're not questioning the truth. Truth is unequivocally true. No, we may have all sorts of questions, like, well, does it stay true? How come there's not, you know? But when we have the opportunity, we have to realize, hey, this is an opportunity to actually experience it and to know and to get the answer to all my questions. Is truth is unequivocally true, and it's always true. So I feel like we get more answers to our questions by not asking questions. This is a way to put it. Okay. To be pragmatic here, the way to get the most answers is to not ask any questions. This is what Rohan Maharshi was getting at. He said, "Why are you silent?" He said, "I'm saying a lot more by being silent. I'm helping a lot more. I'm saying everything by being silent. It's much more effective, actually." He said, because it's encouraging people to get, you know, the answers they really want by experiencing. Experience truth and you'll find the answers have gotten answered. And you no longer have the questions or the concerns. The concerns, you know, questions arise a lot of times from concerns. So we have these concerns, well, you know, how will I be able to do this and this and this? Well, if we experience it, then we'll know. Say, oh, okay, it's fine. It's not a problem. So I don't have all these questions. So as they say, well, first experience it and then see if you have any questions left after that. Or have your concerns been, you know, met and answered properly. First, you know, experience the truth. And so this is the way, actually. that spell has gone away. That's already something. I don't know what's going on in the world so much at all, really. It's probably a good thing, isn't it? Yeah, as I said years ago, or at least a year ago or more, there's going to be traumas every day now in the news. More and more traumas, worse and worse traumas, you know. Are these traumas going to give us answers? Ask yourself, we can ask the question, is that where we're going to find answers? Is all this trauma? Well, if the answer is no, then why pay attention to it? It's like saying a bad smell. Is a bad smell going to be a good smell? No. Then get away from the bad smell. If you want to smell something good, don't be smelling something that stinks. It's like we want to smell something that stinks and say, well, I love that. We're trying to teach ourselves to love fear. Really, is that's what humanism really is, teaching ourselves how to love fear. And of course, we can't love fear, we love truth. Truth loves truth. In the 60s, you know, what happened was is people, young people were complaining that they didn't like the, you know, religious morality of the times, and they felt it was restrictive of their human expression, so they wanted to get rid of it. They said, we want to be able to express ourselves as humans fully. We want to be fully human. So it's been downhill ever since then, really. Human potential movement. It says they say we can only be happy if we're truly human. We're expressing all of our humanness. You know, the good, the bad, the ugly. This is what makes us human. And this is what makes us happy. So this is why you don't have so many in this world now that are, you know, liberated. They've taken the path of repentance. They've taken the path of human potential, which is, you know, you end up living in San Francisco, probably, where, you know, anything goes. That's where, you know, the heart of the human potential movement, the Bay Area. They say, oh, it's so great. They say, oh, it's so great to be human, you know, and to not have to be restricted in any way from expressing our humanness, you know, our fleshiness, our mortality, our vulnerability. It's all so wonderful. We need to celebrate our vulnerability, they say. Celebrate our mortality. You know, don't, you know, try to think that you're, you know, eternal life, but no, let's celebrate this. Celebrate our weakness. They say, we're made whole in our weakness. This is what makes us fully human. This is what God intended us to be. And all the, you know, it just goes on and on and on and on and on. And you get, you know, that has entered into religion too. As religion has been liberalized or humanized, humanism has gotten into religion now. I mean, it's all one coin anyway. But if you listen to Jesus, he says the opposite. He would say this is just, you know, utter whimsy, what humanism is talking about, complete whimsy. And yet, most humanists think that what they're doing, Jesus would, you know, vigorously approve of it. You know, this is what Jesus really was really after, was humanism, human potential. And this is what they think. And nothing could be further from the truth. Yeah, they said, let your hair out and be wild, you know. Go wild, be the wild human being, human person, human animal that you are meant to be. Experience your animal nature. Get in touch with nature, your animal nature. This was what supposedly is going to make us happy. And, you know, we're miserable. The world's miserable now. Absolutely miserable. It's always been miserable, but at least we had the idea of, well, there's something we're doing wrong here. We need to repent, and we don't need to be trying to be more human or more animal. We need to be more spiritual, or somehow find, you know, get right with God somehow. Somehow we're out of alignment with God. You know, we feel, well, when we pretend to be something other than what we are, we feel out of alignment with what we are. Yeah, out of alignment with God. So, in that respect, you know, it is. We're pretend. We're not out of alignment, but we're pretending to be. See, there's a difference. There's a big difference. So it's not like we have to get back in alignment. We just have to drop pretending that we're out of alignment. Pretense is not real. Nobody's out of alignment with God. It's impossible. We're free. How can freedom claim it's out of alignment? With what? It's perfectly free. There isn't any definition of what we are to be out of alignment with. that's the thing about perfect freedom. There's a different smell coming along. Wow. I don't know what to say. Well, that's when it rains a little bit. It liberates all the smells of nature, of autumn. That one's very, I don't know where that's coming from. Some people say sanctity has an odor too with it. And when people are experiencing sanctity, you know, they're not asking questions, really. The idea of asking questions, they would look at that with abhorrence and say, what are you talking about? I don't want to interrupt my experiencing of this to ask questions. And the humanist will say, well, we got a whole bunch of questions. Won't you, you know, ask questions for us? And say, no, why don't you come in here and experience this? And then, you know, you'll realize that experiencing is better than asking these questions. You know, little children, when they're trying to, the world seems overwhelming. Why is this? Why is this? Yeah, why did you do that? Why? You know, they're baffled. Why does everything happen the way it happens? That's the ego is asking that. Nothing's happening. No thingness is happening. No concreteness is happening. No situation is happening. No circumstance is happening. No outcome is happening. Nothing is happening. How can anything happen to freedom? Pure freedom, perfect freedom. How can anything happen to it? How can it say, well, something's happening to me? No, it's impossible. And so we need to experience this. The impossibility of all our beliefs. Not to have all our beliefs ask question after question after question. It goes nowhere. Basically say there isn't any question about it, about what we are. There's no question at all. This is probably a better way to look at it. Just say, there is no question. It's completely unquestionable. probably better we you know, keep pushing the envelope here in that direction. Maybe that's why, you know, that this the situation the way it is. There's no meeting with, you know, with people, because it's meant to be something that's quiet, that's not questioned, that we feel where we're able to just not question. Practice not questioning. This is how we get ready for abidance. Abidance is unquestionably true. There's nothing to question there. You're experiencing you know that this is the way that it is. There's nothing to question. We can say, well, why is it the way that it is? But is that a question about the way it is? No, it's not a question about the way it is. It's kind of a statement like, well, I want to change it. Well, if you want to change it, then knock yourself out. You know, that's not a question. It's really a statement saying, I want to change it. Okay? Can't change it, but if you want to believe you can, then that's it. But really, the most question really is how to say, well, is there some way to change this? Is there some way we can separate from us? Is there some way we can? That's the way the questions. But no, I say they're really statements that they want to. But okay, fine, you want to. They're worried, like, well, what's going to happen to me? You know, if I keep trying to change, it's nothing. Nothing's going to happen. Nothing can happen to us. And then they might say, well, you know, I know something's going to happen. All sorts of stuff's been happening. I'm kind of worried something real terrible might happen. No, nothing's been happening to anyone. There's no happenings taking place. There's just pretending. And pretending always remains pretending. So, you know, what's the question? There's no question. I mean, pretense is pretense. And truth is truth. So we can pretend that all sorts of stuff is happening to us, but from the standpoint of truth, nothing is happening to us at all. Nothing can happen to us. Pretense is not something happening to us. It's a pretending that something is happening to us, but it's not an actual something happening to us. Yeah, it certainly is autumn. It feels like autumn now. That moisture certainly did it. It flipped the seasons. Well, what can you do? But that too is a pretense. So if someone says, well, what if I didn't want truth to be true? Well, then you'd have to pretend. That's the answer. You'd have to pretend. Isn't any other, they say, well, isn't there some other way? No, there's not any other way. pretending is the only avenue there is. If you want to try to experience something other than truth, you have to pretend. There isn't any other way. All outcomes are pretense. There cannot ever be a triumph. You know, duality doesn't really exist. It's just 100% pretense. You can't have light defeating darkness. What is darkness except our own freedom expressing and appearing? And we're completely free to experience anything else in an instant. How can there be a triumph? The word, the notion, the concept of triumph is completely foreign to reality. There's no concretization of darkness or anything. So there is no other way other than pretending. If we don't want to experience reality, then we just simply have to pretend that we're not experiencing it. There isn't any other way. Maybe that's what they're asking. And then they say, oh my God, you mean I have to go through this continuity fear? Yeah, that's right. Yeah, that's true. There isn't any other way. I keep thinking, oh, maybe I can find some other way, and then I don't have to let go of pretense. I've found some other way that works, change reality, or not experience it. See, most don't try to, they're not aware of the continuity fear, so they feel that they're blocked somehow, and they feel like it's some, that God is blocking them, and truth is blocking them, and there's nothing they can do about it, so they have to find some other way other than pretense, that they got no choice but to be separate from reality. Now, as soon as we recognize this is continuity fear, our whole approach changes, and we start actually paying attention and listening, and our questioning starts dropping away. We realize, oh, this is just continuity fear that's bothering me. And I can evaporate that through right spiritual practice and familiarity. I evaporate the continuity fear, so I don't need to be asking all these questions about, well, what if I can't get back home? What kind of home can I have if I can't get back home? Well, we never left home, actually. So the idea of getting back home is a false question. You know, how do I get back home? I never left. We only need to realize we never left. Not, we don't need to get back home. We need to realize we never left. This is very different. We never left freedom. We're still expressing freedom here. Even in our pretending, we're expressing freedom because we can stop pretending at any instant we want to. Or we can lessen the intensity of the pretending at any instant we want to. We're still completely free. Everyone is still completely free. So, again, nothing is really happening at all. There is no happening. So from the standpoint of thinking this world is some place where we go have stuff happen, there is no such world. And as far as like stuff happening to the body, there is no such body. There's not a happening world or a happening body. And infirmities, etc., is just our attempt to show one another, oh yeah, look, something is happening to me. See, I believe in happening. We don't have to be sick. We don't have to be infirm. We don't really have to at all. Now, I've had many instances of infirmities coming on the body and then deciding, no, I don't want this right now. And maybe later, and it goes away. And recently I've had some that have not been able to do this with. It means it's a very strong kind of belief. You know, I got to have some infirmity. You know, people like saying, like if you could not wear down at all, people might say, oh great, you can work for me a lot. No, they would freak them out. You know, that's unfair. You're going to get more money, you're going to get more promotions, you know, you're going to get ahead, and I'm not. That's those stairways are really, you know, in the idea that not having wearing down at all, people would, that would cause them to, you know, pull you into some sort of like, oh, you need to be a great golfer, a great athlete, or a great something because you don't wear out and everything. No, they'd say, hey, it's not fair that you're competing with me. You know, I don't want you doing this. So basically, you know, the greatest thing is to sit quietly. And this is what takes, you know, the less worn out you are, the easier it is to do it. And plus, you're not after outcomes. The lack of being worn down in any way doesn't mean that you then can pursue outcomes endlessly. No, you're not worn down because you realize there's no such thing as outcomes. So you're not trying to give any evidence of such in the body. So you wouldn't be trying to go out and break records and do all this stuff. No. I mean, if you did anything, it would just be for fun. Well, we don't have to be infirm in any way, actually. This is just false evidence. It's pretending that outcomes are real. And that I've been, you know, so I've been pursuing outcomes, and therefore I've had a life. We think pursuing outcomes means we've had a life. Had a life. We want to look back and say, oh, I had a life. Therefore, I must not be what I really am. Eternal life. Is he saying I had a life means I don't have eternal life, doesn't it? Absolutely. Had a life, but now it's over. Infirmity struck. We use the body as an excuse. The body's just an excuse mechanism, actually. That's all it is. Just we project these excuses and say, well, the body causing me to die, so I don't have eternal life. I can say I had a life, but it's gone. The body is never alive in the first place. There's no life in the body. It's neutral. So how can we say that when the body's gone, that means we don't have a life anymore? That's ridiculous. but never had a life in the first place can hardly be said to be dispossessing us of it, of life. Just experienced a faint glimpse of truth there. So the thing to do is just full stop in the wow, don't struggle with it. Just get used to the aftermath of glimpsing truth, right? So that's what we do. We don't try to remember what it was. It was very subtle, very beautiful. You just say, okay, now I had a glimpse. Now I'm going to just manage my success and see how I feel. Because if once we do that successfully, we say, well, I can do it again. It's not going to cause a big ruckus within me. And the mind continues on wandering as before, but for a moment there, it was like a current of truth, a little current of truth there, faintly in the distance sort of, but I recognized it, said, ah, there you are. There's a nice note there, a note of truth, noting it. Maybe the Hammond organ has a lot of notes there, so it's like a lot of a tremendous constellation of noticing, you know, noting it, taking note of it. The deluded. Ask, they say, hey, do you know some way I can be apart from truth other than pretense? Because a pretense seems vulnerable to dropping the pretense. I want to make something stronger than pretense, and this is scaring me. And they can, I'm so scared, can you help me? Well, yeah. Evaporate the continuity fear is how anyone can be helped. It's the only way. There isn't some other way to avoid truth other than pretense. And pretense is always vulnerable to us to stop pretending. And this is why they're scared. I feel so scared, so much anxiety. I feel like I might stop pretending, and I'd be in my annihilation. So can you show me some way to... You must have be happy because you found some way other than pretending. No, I found a way of gradually evaporating the continuity fear to the point where it no longer bothered me anymore to be aware that truth is true, just experience that truth is true. They say, but you're great, and I'm just so small. Surely you have something from me who are so ignorant. No, all that ignorance and smallness, that's all pretense. It's not true. And they say, but I'm, you know, so this is the struggle. When the idea of people wanting to get rid of what they don't like is that truth is true because it threatens pretense. So I say, can you just get rid of the truth within truth? You know, we like, you know, we want to be happy, but we don't want truth to be true and truth to make us happy. We want some other happiness, human happiness. This is why humanism is pursuing, you know, human happiness. They think that'll protect them from the happiness that truth brings. That's what they're terrified of. Continuity fear, nothing other than that. That's what the path of repentance is all about. Evaporating continuity fear through right spiritual practice. This is a backrest. I'm trying to take some pressure off my back. Okay. Get sore from hitting golf. You know, golf is terrible for the body. Hurts your back. It really does. Back problems, shoulder problems, hip problems, all sorts of problems from golf. It's terrible. Really. We're not meant to, like, torque and swing our, you know, like that a whole bunch, you know. It's unnatural. So remember, when we get a glimpse of truth, we're evaluating ourselves, saying, can I handle this? So we want to continue on, you know, sitting quietly, not doing anything, and not getting carried away in any way. So we can prove to ourselves that, hey, that wasn't so bad. My world didn't just collapse. So when you have a glimpse of truth, give it some time, you know, right? I mean, you deserve it. It's not like after 5 minutes you say, oh, okay, it's enough time. No. It's extraordinary. Taking note like that, I just caught this little glimpse. That means it's not so far beneath the surface, if we want to speak that way. That we're really bringing it to light here. It's not buried anymore. You know, it's like you're whisking off some dust off of an archaeological dig, and then there you see something, or a gold dig. You're digging for something, and you see a little bit of its surfaces. Oh, wow, you know, it's very profound like that way. But it's near the surface, very near the surface, when we're able to catch a glimpse like this. So then the focus would be, well, how do I feel with truth being so near to me? You say, I'm so near to it. How does that make me feel? Focus on that. Don't try to remember. What was that? What was that? I can explain. Let me answer. You know, how was that? You know, not pretense and get it. No. How does it feel to be so close to truth? This is then the question you put yourself. How does it feel to be so close, knowing you're so close, like this, really, really close? This is the way to get the momentum even stronger. That's true that we've been close before many times, but the world, you know, keeps doubling down and doubling down and doubling down, right? And the answer, you know, the questions get more and more intense. Like, you know, we've got to find some way to deny truth other than pretense. You know, the world, so it seems irrelevant to deal with pretense the way we're doing it. The world keeps saying, well, that's irrelevant. It's irrelevant. It's irrelevant. It's irrelevant. So we have to keep bringing it back to relevancy. This is what's so important. Because they're saying, well, we have to find a way, so we will. No, we'll never find a way to deny truth that isn't anything other than just pretense. But if we were to, then what they're saying is, they're hoping they will, they're believing they will, so they say, well, what we're talking about here is completely irrelevant to them. Because we're talking about evaporating the continuity of fear over pretense. And they say, well, you know, once we find another way, that'll be completely irrelevant. So it attempts, you know, to subvert, you know, our will. It's the very subversive. The world right now is extremely subversive. Trying to subvert our will to carry through here. So we keep trying, and then the world keeps doubling down, saying it's irrelevant. What you're doing is completely irrelevant. I got no interest in it. We're real close to finding something, some way other than pretense to distract us from truth, to deny truth. And no, they're not closer to pretense. They're just pretending in different ways. You know, just using the creativity to keep pretending. You know, if we're pretending to be a dog, you know, we'd be like, maybe we're barking louder and more often and growling louder, you know, but it's still, you know, it doesn't make us more a dog. It means we're just pretending stronger. I was taking a nap. I woke up at 6:52. Like I was like shocked. I said, "What the heck is going on here? 6:52? Well, 6 would be June. I had 52 days. 30 days out of September, April, June. Just 30 days. So that would be July 12th. It would take us to July 12th. Now I say we need to be ready by June 21st because we want a little grace period here. But I understand it that actually in July. And it could be July 12th, that's when the full, you know, grip might be felt, you know. But we don't want to wait till July 12th. We want to be done by the 21st of June. And that's not that far away, is it, right now? It's like about 9 months or less than that. Well, October, November, December, yeah. That would be 9 months and 21 days minus a couple of days, so we're 9 months and 19 days away from June 21st. and that's so being shocked awake, I felt like a, oh wow, it was really, I said, uh-oh, this is a very strong impulse. What's the impulse? Is they will say that, you know, this emphasis we have here of seeing truth is totally irrelevant. They will say, you know, we're certain that we're going to find something other than pretense, and we'll shift over to that, and therefore we won't be experiencing any more fear, because the fear of dropping pretense. They'll know the whole thing about pretense is we're saying, well, there's someone who's doing the pretending, or they can stop it in an instant, right? That's what pretense means. So they're terrified of that. So they want to say, no, it's not pretense. It's materiality. I mean, this world is real. This whole universe is real. This is time-space process form is real. And humanism is real. We're really... So nothing can, you know, that we can't drop it. It's not pretense. It's nature. You know, what we're doing is reality, you know, not pretense. And they'll be so strongly into that there'd be some pulse. There's something like pulse. The world will be pulsed to believe that evaporating the continuity fear of the spiritual path is totally irrelevant. And those that do that, you know, engaging in irrelevance is crazy. Something like that. A very strong pulse. So, oh wow, that's not good at all. I went into a very heavy sleep this afternoon, so tired. I kept waking up from it and going back. I said, wow, it's a heavy time now in the world, isn't it? So if we wonder, well, why have we not had the breakthroughs, etc., it's because the world keeps doubling down so severely. So we do get close, and then we get this feeling from the world like, well, so what? It's completely irrelevant. It has no more relevance to us. We're not interested. Because we found a way other than pretending to deny truth, you know, to not experience truth. This is not true. They just continue to pretending to say they're not. They say they found another way, and they haven't at all. No one has, not in the slightest bit. But the world can make it seem that way. So then we kind of like say, well, maybe I need to dig deeper. You know, I mean, to, you know, how do I accommodate? How can I help these people who are not pretending, you know, but they are, you know, it seems irrelevant, you know, truth seems irrelevant to them because they say they found some way other than pretense, but they have not. So, but it causes us then to delays us, it delays us, it delays us. So there's this battle here of delay taking place. Flooding, 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 flooding's on the minds of the world. It seems like so many places are experiencing such terrible flooding. It's just amazing. Carolinas, you know, are looking at something like that, heavy rain. I don't, but California, maybe this winter. Flooding, flooding, flooding. It's flooding all over the world. The world's being flooded with distraction. But what I feel is through the decades, the irrelevancy in people's attitudes towards spiritual truth has become, they're saying it's more and more and more and more and more irrelevant, more and more irrelevant. We have the preeminent atheist, what Richard Dawkins here is in the Bay Area, just giving talks this weekend, basically saying all this stuff about religion, you know, is completely irrelevant, folks. You know, now we found science. Science tells us that nature is real, and you know, we're bodies and we're humans, and so all this mumbo jumbo nonsense, fairy tale, tooth fairy stuff, it's completely irrelevant. And people are, you know, just soaking this in, saying, "Oh, good, good, good. That makes me feel more secure." You know, I have this jitters of, I don't, you know, this is like magic. They don't know what's wrong with them. So when they hear that someone's saying, "Well, you know, we're humans. This is nature. This is set in stone. This is what we are," they feel less frightened because they think, "Oh, maybe I'm not pretending." So therefore, if I'm not pretending, I can't immediately, you know, stop pretending. So they feel that it protects them from something. So they get this, you know, warm, fuzzy feeling from this. But, you know, it doesn't work. It ultimately wears off. Then you have to use other means to try and get that warm, fuzzy feeling. So it's very relevant tonight to recognize this. Wow, I keep getting frustrated, wondering why haven't I made it yet? You know, what, you know, I keep getting glimpses of truth. Now I see that. Then I look at the world and say, okay, how do I present this? And you know, and I see the world is from the standpoint of the world, this is becoming more and more and more irrelevant, extraordinarily irrelevant. They say, I don't see any relevancy to this at all. You know, and I think, oh, I got to dig deeper. I got to do better, but. Really, no. You can't do better than abidance. You know, you cannot do any better. But it kind of you know adds a delay in there, because when people just let's say so with such certainty, well, that's just irrelevant. It's shocking. You know, the basic reaction, you know, to these videos is among most of the people in the world is completely irrelevant. So that has an effect, thinking like, well, what's the use? You know, what's the use of even trying? If everyone here thinks it's irrelevant, it has an effect, a chilling effect. Remember, triumph is complete pretense. So they're out trying to triumph over, you know, good triumphing over evil, light triumphing over darkness. That's all 100% pretense. But they're trying to figure out some way where symbolically it's not. Well, so the symbols are pretense, you know. it means nothing. It's still 100% pretense, so. Hopefully we can dial it in, you know, pull out all the stops, dial in on the tone wheels of the Hammond B3 organ, dial those tone wheels in so we get the right tone we need. Start playing some great music. Well, there's another odor coming through. Wow. Similar. The autumn has, you can feel it, autumn is an interesting time. I hope the deers aren't coming. I have a flashlight in case they do. So truth, we're very near to truth here. And yet the world is frantically pushing the idea that it's irrelevant. Which is why I stopped watching the news, because that's really all the news is saying, that truth is irrelevant. We don't need a spiritual path that's irrelevant. We have science. Science, which says that, you know, everything is happening to us. You know, that's basically science. That, yeah, all this stuff is happening to us. Let us enumerate and catalog all the stuff that happens to us that can happen in the universe. It's just a complete delusion. Nothing is happening to our freedom. To freedom. Nothing happens to freedom ever. But you know, now we'd say, well, we have computers. We can record, you know, and store even more happenings, infinite happenings, which make, you know, the spiritual path completely irrelevant. They say, so they say, and so the computer age has really put a deep freeze, you know, a delay on the whole situation. You know, what kind of evidence is pretend evidence? There's no, you got a computer, pretend computer, storing, you know, infinite amount of pretend evidence. So, evidence, what is it evidence of? For pretense. So how does that change anything? Not at all. Has the computer age changed anything? Not at all. Has the situation changed? Not in the slightest. Remember, the B3 was before computers. Like, when they stopped selling the B3? In 1975 or something like that, I don't know. And they started going into, you know, the just the electric keyboards, so to speak. You know, they went into that, the synthesizers, and started going into that. Nowadays, you don't, specializes in restoring B3s and selling them, actually. That's pretty cool. Wouldn't mind having one, but I think it's really relating to spiritual noting, being able to note truth. I don't think I really want to spend time, you know, actually playing, you know, keyboard or anything like that, an instrument. Now there's another smell. Wow. What is going on there? That's very strong. It's different. Some kind of activity in the neighborhood. You know what's really cool about this neighborhood? You never hear music. Nobody's blasting any music ever. It's quiet. Of course, these days, people use headphones for this. Headphones. We used to blast music. I used to. You know, I always felt guilty of it. Though I stopped. I said, I can't keep doing this because, what if the neighbors don't like it? You know. You reach some point where you start to be aware that when you're kids, you don't think of that so much. But then you get older, and you say, wait a minute, you know, do I really need to subject the neighbors to this super loud amplified music? People used to have parties all the time, Friday, Saturday night, with live bands in their houses. They'd get a garage band, you know, come here play for beer. And so they'd play till, you know, 1 or 2 in the morning, loud music, loud parties. I actually had my amplifier stolen. I left it there. I think one night I was playing there and never saw it again. It was like I think it was like a silver tone or something. I literally liked that amp. And, you know, just like, hey, someone left their amplifier here. Oh, cool. You know, well, let me see how it sounds. I'll take it home and play with it. Play, and this is what happened. Yeah, people up the street used to have parties back in the day. So many, many parties all the time. Huge parties with loud, you know, live music. But that stopped. It's been gentrified, which isn't a bad thing. It helps us do our thing here like this. Nowhere do we hear a hint of live music, where we used to. Oh gosh. Back in the 60s, 70s, 80s, 90s, I mean, you hear live music on a Friday night? For sure. Doesn't happen anymore. Well, the kids are all away at college these days. See, this is the thing in this area. Everyone's kids are shipped off to college. And they're all studying really hard to get into really good college, so they don't party very much. Where back in the day, there's a lot of people that high school was it for them, you know. And so the kids were around. They wanted to party, you know, live bands, but the kids are not around anymore. That age group, you know, 18, 19, 20, 21, and, you know, up in their 20s, they're not around anymore here. I'd say just, you know, you rarely see people of that age group here. They all go to college, almost all, in this area especially. And they do their partying there in the college towns, but not here. And also people leave town here every weekend. They go somewhere. I don't know where. Where is there to go? I can't think of any place I'd want to go, actually. Well, except just one. Yeah, I would. But really, where is there to go? Wherever we go, it's all pretense. You know, we can't escape this fact. We keep thinking if we keep moving around, you know, we're getting away from it, but no, we're not. I thought a couple of days ago, what would I like to do? And it came up nothing. There's nothing, nowhere I'd like to go, nothing I want to do. I can't think of anything that really interests me here in this world. Nothing whatsoever, actually. Except witnessing to the truth, that's it. You know, if I went over my mind, do I want to do this? I said, well, not really, no, not really, don't. How would you like to go to Europe? No, not really. Go out to some great restaurant? Not really. Go to a great concert? No, not really. No. I didn't feel any deprivation. If I didn't do anything in this world whatsoever, I don't think I'd feel deprived at all. Do I really want to go walking in nature? Not really. So I couldn't come up with one single situation where I would feel I really want to do this and I'd feel deprived if I don't do it. Not one. I was looking at some musicians and bands and how they, jamming, and they seemed to be having so much fun. I looked down and I realized, that's not that much fun. I've been there, done that. Do I really miss it? No, not really. If I wasn't doing it, do I feel really deprived? Not really, no. Well, let's say, well, what if we get set up with some, like, super great recording studio, all the great studio musicians, great songs we record. Would you want to do that? Nah, not really. Not really, no. Would you want to have some hit songs? No, not really. If I could have some hit songs, no, not really. I don't feel deprived at all, of that. How about concerts? Out there giving concerts? No, not really. If you could go out there and give concerts, go on a world tour. Do I really want to do that? No. Just a waste of time. It's all still pretense. So for me, just hanging out like this is as good as it gets, actually, right now. Socializing, want to socialize? Not really. But abundance, yeah, that's what I really want. And of course, abundance answers the question, what is abundance? That is, abundance is the answer to the question, what is abundance? Experiencing truth is the truth. Some motorcycles you're going to hear going really fast there. Late on the freeway. Probably just maxing out, it sounded like. Wow, you can still hear them. So truth is very near. It's just that the world sees it as irrelevant. So it's difficult to make that breakthrough into abidance. But again, the fact that everybody sees it as irrelevant is even more reason to abide. Otherwise, we'll just feel miserable here. You know, cause no one, hardly anyone will pay any attention to what we have to say. So we might as well be compensated with abidance. You know, that's the only way to compensate ourselves for such a situation. You know, so it's all the more reason, the more irrelevant they say it is, it's all the more reason to make sure that we're abiding. At least we get that, you know, bliss from that. We're certainly not going to get it from anybody, you know, from the world agreeing and say, yeah, we need to work on this. And not now. Who knows what people do? I don't know. I don't think there's many in this area that are doing this taping like this, or spending time this way, or focused like this. Probably not many in the world. There's some that are focusing in, yeah. I don't know. So what else is everybody doing? I don't know. It certainly isn't very relevant to, you know, what really needs to be done. Probably watching a movie or watching television, or, you know, which is very distracting. Waiting for science to proclaim that there's some way other than pretense to, you know, not to be unaware of truth. So then they, waiting for science to get them off the hook. That's the problem here. Everybody's waiting for science to get them off the hook. Science will never get us off the hook. Only right spiritual practice will get us off the hook of continuity fear. So people are just waiting in vain. But they may even go into a whole other cycle, scientific cycle, scientific humanism of you know, so I think that they can find something that's, you know, something solid. It's not pretense. Not possible. So when you feel that people view you as you're irrelevant, all the more reason for abidance, right? All the more reason to abide in truth, experience it. Because otherwise, people just continue to just think you're totally irrelevant. Your beliefs, you know, and what you feel, what you really want, they're going to keep more and more and more and more. Irrelevancy, totally irrelevant. This is the trend of the world. Super irrelevant. Well, they throw you a bunch of bones of dog treats of spirituality, you know, just to keep the dog satisfied. But the real truth they say is it's irrelevant. They think they're going to find an option, an alternative to pretense, some other way. What they really mean is they're going to pretend in a different way. It's still completely pretense. It's like the comedian who does someone's voice, you know, pretends to be someone else's voice, and then they say, okay, well, and then they say, and then they do another voice, they change to another voice, say, okay, I'm going to pretend to do another voice here, but this is it's different. No, it's still 100% pretense. Wow, those motorcycles are still going at it. That is crazy. That's weird. Friday night. So we're just sitting here quietly. We're very close to truth. So we're just getting, you know, saying, okay, I can just sit here quietly and not be bothered by that. That's very important. We don't have to be having some profound thoughts by sitting quietly. It doesn't have to be profound. It's just that we're proving to ourselves that I don't get all out of control when I glimpse the truth. It doesn't cause me to, you know, get out of control in any way. I'm just sitting here quietly. I can maintain my composure, no problem. So when you glimpse the truth, just sit quietly for as long as you want until, you know, you just feel, wow, that I'm able to take it in stride. Okay, so we're getting ready to wrap this one up. Very productive, very, very, very helpful video for me. Gotta get ready, right? Because it could be it's time to pull out all the stops. That's what it certainly seems to be telling us, time to pull out all the stops here. Because by June 21st, 2016, we don't want to be, you know, we want to have some relationship with the Bidens in some way, because the world will go into this uber irrelevancy mode, you know, at that time. And so we don't want to be pulled into that. That could really submerge us, could flood us, as it were. We have to be ahead of the game. Have to be ahead of the game at that time. So let us be ahead of the game here, for sure. And you can say, well, you know, if something violence happens now, you say, well, you know, what I'm just doing is I'm just preparing for June 21st, 2016, which I feel is a point, a tipping point of where the world will think this is all completely irrelevant. So I'm just, you know, getting ready for that, like getting ready for an exposition to the Himalayas or something. I'm just, this is part of my prepping that I'm doing for that time period. You can look at it that way. It's a nice way to look at it. This is just I'm getting ready for, you know, an onslaught of delusion here in the world. So I'll be able to withstand it. So, yeah, that's a great way to look at it. Don't claim any absoluteness, like, yeah, I'm in abidance, this, I'm not. You can say, well, yeah, I'm in abidance, but this is something I'm doing, you know, as part of my prep, overall prep for, you know, this tipping point in the world. And I want to, you know, be able to be really, really grounded in this by that time. So it buys you some time. Say, well, I need to at least work on grounding this for the next 9 months because it's just still part of my preparation. So we want to be very, 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 very grounded in this. So we better get going right away, right away. Okay, that's how I feel. Very great. Let's get going. Let's pull out all the stops right now. That's it.